Mini episode 661 of the FDH Lounge is brought to you by The Unheard Scene, your home for great music interviews of all stripes. Follow them on the web at unheardscene.com.
The FDH Lounge. You want to schedule your life around it.
A long time ago, on a gloomy, wet Cleveland spring night, two men stand alone amidst the late night drizzle. Their voices echo across the vacant station parking lot as they debate the merits of the great American radio show that have been missing for far too long. On that night, an idea was born. That idea became the FDH Lounge. Welcome to the FDH Lounge.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the FDH Lounge. Rick Morris and Kyle Ross here with Part 4B of the History of Royal Rumble Anthology. We are talking 2001. This era is 2000 to 2002 that we are covering. We've already got 2000 behind us. Again, as I always preface this by saying, if you want to hear our overall take on the Royal Rumble, structure of it, what it would come to be subsequently, Part 1A, 1988, we spend a good 10 to 15 minutes at least setting all that stuff up. Every year we just kind of jump right into it, set up the macro a little bit in terms of where the landscape is of the company before we get into the card. So 2001, Kyle, we are coming off of the hottest business year in the history of the company, and of course there's the sense that things can only go down from here, although we weren't thinking that at the time.
Oh.
There was no sense that it had a peak.
I should bring that up. I had some issues with the booking, I remember, at the time.
Okay. Well, the fall of 2000, it was already starting to go down, in the main event scene anyways.
Well, there were, for the first time since the company had overtaken WCW, some WCW-like mistakes, I thought, from the WWE.
Is that overstating it a little, or in terms of the magnitude of what WCW-level mistakes would come to be?
I think not pushing guys, not listening to fans, I don't think that's overstating.
Okay.
I think
not on
they
the
were
magnitude
strong
of
enough that, you know, with Rock and then Austin coming back, that it didn't matter at the time.
Mm-hmm.
But I think there were decisions that were made around this time period, certainly going into 2002, that wound up hurting this company moving forward.
I do
the
agree with
that. The present was very good, but the future, quite frankly, 3 months after this show, what should have been the all-time period for this company actually was not. I want to be quite disappointing.
Right.
You talk about macro things. My 3 points for this 2000 to 2002 era, which is part four, as you said, calling it from the war to the game because the Monday Night Wars are ending. We're seeing the ascension of Triple H, a.k.a. the game. The other point I'd like to make is that this is the period that the Rumble really surpassed SummerSlam, in my opinion, as the number two pay-per-view in the company. 2001 did a monstrous 625,000 on pay-per-view, wound up beating SummerSlam by 60,000. And remember, that SummerSlam came after the biggest non-Big Four pay-per-view ever, too, keeping that in mind.
That's right.
That being the Invasion pay-per-view, also in Cleveland. We get to talk a lot of Cleveland pay-per-views when we do this together.
That's right. Fittingly.
So, business was good, at least in the WWE side of things. In the WCW side of things, business was not very good. As a matter of fact, it was almost closed for good. Again, part three was the Monday Night Wars era of this history, the Rumble. And WCW here goes out of business 2 months later.
Here's an interesting thing about that. Let me just say this. We always talk about the Royal Rumble to WrestleMania period. We're here to talk today about the Royal Rumble, but by WrestleMania, we would be from three major companies in this country down to one, ECW and WCW, biting the bullet more or less simultaneously right before WrestleMania 17.
Yes, and it sucked. I think in retrospect, it sucked.
Yep.
It's not, I mean, Vince McMahon loves it. I'm sure all the people in the front office love it. If you work for the WWE, you would love it. But I don't think it's good for wrestling as a whole.
No.
That we only have one company. And I think that was what led to some of their arrogance with these decisions moving forward. You know, we kind of talked about how in the 2000 Rumble, that WCW, what they were doing, was no longer relevant to WWE's decision-making. And I think sometimes it led to arrogant decision making, like some of the guys who would come over maybe not getting pushed to the most of their abilities, Jericho, Benoit, to name a couple.
Right.
But look, let's not sugarcoat this. With the return of Steve Austin in late 2000, thank you. I would have left my wallet here.
I was afraid of that.
Yes. This company was on fire. This was peak roster for me. The roster was at its height. And we talk about in some of the last couple Rumbles, you know, one of the big things, talking points, disagreements, call it what you will, you and I had with our respective enjoyments of 98 and 2000 is that I just didn't think the depth was there in those. The depth was here in 2001, and the depth is present in the fact that we reference this into the 2001 Part 4A, that you didn't have the undercard guys coming back to work the Rumble here. So
right.
This was really deep, and the talent that had come over in the last year. Right after 2000, the Radicals come over. Benoit, Guerrero, Malenko, Saturn. Now, Malenko and Saturn quickly kind of faded into the abyss,
right,
which I thought was unfair. They could have got a little bit more of them. Don't think either of them could have been huge stars like Benoit and Guerrero were. I just don't. But I think
Saturn, maybe? I mean, no. Malenko's personality would have hurt him.
No,
held
I thought
him
they
back.
Could have, I thought if they would have kept them as a group,
mm-hmm.
You know, Benoit is the lead, Guerrero is the middle, and Malenko and Saturn could have been a great tag team.
Tag team, certainly, yeah.
I thought, you know, they could have kind of done a little Tully and Arn thing, maybe. I don't know.
Right.
But, last, they didn't. Jericho, Big Show, who else? And, you know, all these ECW guys had started to come in by 2001. You know, this roster was just really loaded. It was on fire. You had no idea. If you turn this on, you would have no idea that in a couple years this company would have cooled off.
Right. That's absolutely the case.
So, especially with the returning Steve Austin, who, it needs to be stated, you know, we kind of glossed over his non-participation in 2000. Remember when he returned for Unforgiven 2000?
Yeah.
It was the angle he was going to find who would run him down in the car angled Survivor Series?
Right.
Are you aware of how many buys that show did?
I am not.
Unforgiven 98. Guess which year he... Well, I just told you, damn it, I screwed it up. But anyway, Unforgiven 98 did 309,000. He was on that show.
Okay.
Unforgiven 99, he was a referee in a six-pack main event, 330,000. Unforgiven 2001, he was a heel champion there, did 350,000. 2002, Unforgiven did 300,000. 2003, Unforgiven did 360,000. So you have a... You're seeing, like, there's a baseline for that September pay-per-view, right?
That's right.
It's, like, basically 300 to 360,000. Unforgiven 2000, Steve Austin's return did 605,000 buys.
Wow.
That, ladies and gentlemen, is a box office draw.
Yep.
Now, interestingly, Judgment Day, when he actually wrestled, he were against... Oh, no, that was... See, this is out of order, because Judgment Day was the May pay-per-view, actually, in 2000. What did No Mercy do in 2005-50 when he were so, you know.
The point still holds.
Yeah. Business was good.
Yeah.
And you had a really talented roster, and I think that this show, although I don't think it gets the, maybe I'm just reading the wrong people, I don't see a lot of people saying that this top to bottom is just as good as 2000. I think it's pretty damn close, man. The main event, being the world, or I shouldn't say that. The world title match, scratch main event, world title match, is not as good here.
Right.
By any means, but there's still a match of the year contender on this show. The Rumble here is better.
Yeah, I think it's a little better.
I think it's a lot better, actually.
Okay.
That's the difference. I think it's a lot better. I honestly, you know I kind of stopped you and you said, oh, you know, we like 2001. I'm like, oh, let's not go that far yet.
Right.
It's close. I think it's a lot. It's 6-1, half a dozen to the other for me, maybe.
What's interesting
is it's a hot crowd in New Orleans.
Yeah.
And it just, you know, you talk about how the product was hot in 98, 99. It was the it product. Man, you watch this. I mean, this they were on top of the freaking world, it looked like. Even though, like, the booking, I had issues with the booking. But
right.
When you just watch this show in 2015 and you kind of forget about, you know, this pissed me off on SmackDown, this pissed me off on Raw. If you just watch this show, holy God, I mean, there were just so many guys that were over the main event scene so much better. I mean, they had like eight guys on this show. Maybe that's exaggerating. Five or six that were more over than the most over guy today.
I don't know this point for sure, But I thought that I had seen online, I won't go so far as to say a consensus, but most people that I had seen online, and I agree with you, I think the 01 Rumble match itself is a little better than 2000, but 2000 seems to be commonly regarded by many as the second best ever. So we may be sort of an outlier here as far as what we think. I don't know that for sure.
Wait, we may be.
I think the majority of people think the 2000 Royal Rumble match is a shade better than 01. I think we may be an outlier.
I don't think so. Oh, I don't know. I think it's generally regarded that the match itself, mm-hmm. everyone prefers 01. I think I'm on the lower end of 01, quite frankly. I like
okay.
01 Rumble. There are people who think this 01 Rumble is like a candidate for best Rumble ever.
All right.
There are a lot. It makes my top five. It's number five.
It makes my top five on what is so far. I got it at 4.25, above 2000's 4 stars, below 1992's 4.5 stars. So I got it slotted
now. At five, as you know, and it's not. And number two won't be close to that.
Right.
But I gave this 3.75,
okay.
which so far, of all the Rumbles we talked about, is my second highest. It's going to end up being the fifth highest.
Okay, and I haven't rewatched any of the ones past 02.
Okay.
I'd be shocked if I stacked any of them higher, so this is probably going to be my second highest.
Okay, well, we'll talk about that. Let's talk about the show top to bottom, though.
Yep.
There's some interesting things, by the way. We, you know, again, we're talking about, you know, WCW is an effector. There's Triple H still figures prominently in here.
Right.
We are calling this the War of the Games, so we'll be talking about Triple H.
That's right.
And, you know, we've already kind of touched on business, so let's go with the matches.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why I felt the need to do that interlude. That was kind of stupid. Scratch that out
of
post-production.
Worked.
It was stupid.
Oh, that
dumb.
Worked.
I thought I had a point there. It was stupid. I didn't have shit.
it worked till you started bad-mouthing it.
That's why. Whatever. I think the bad-mouthing was more entertaining. All right. The opener here is Edge and Christian against the Dudleys.
Yeah.
Tag match. It's funny. It's a straight tag match. No tables and no ladders involved. In my notes, I had that I really enjoyed this, and it was nice to see these guys doing a match that got over in front of the crowd without the need for tables and ladders and them killing themselves.
Right.
Now, there was the slight issue of concussions in this match and how they were liberally talking about how Bubba Ray was dealing with a concussion. Oh, how long can he go?
Yep.
And they were kind of like, this is, now, I don't want to excuse WWE, but this was kind of before everyone knew about the severity of
right.
concussions. And I remember, like, Jim Ross kept saying concussed at the time. I remember watching this live. By the way, do you know where I watched this show live at?
Where?
A church at OU. There was, like, this...
The Hare Krishnas?
I don't know if it was that. It was on, oh, God, what street was it? So I lived on East State.
Probably UCC, right? I can
yes.
see them. How did I guess?
I think. I shouldn't convert that because, you know me, I don't know anything about religion. I don't know what denomination it was. All I know was I lived on East State, I shouldn't give away addresses.
I
lived on East State Street, and like a couple, if you just walked up like a few blocks, there was this church there. And it was whatever street came right into East State.
Mm-hmm.
And they were like, yeah, we're going to show. And back then, we didn't. You know, in my house, we didn't have the capability to get pay-per-view.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, again, I'm in college. I talked about it in 2000. I didn't watch this show live.
Okay.
Well, I did watch this show live, but I didn't watch most WWF pay-per-views live at that time because I didn't have the capability.
Okay.
So I was like, all right, screw it. And I remember when I watched this not enjoying it as much as I should have. Because I kind of was souring on the booking a little bit, but B, I was watching it by myself. Like, none of my roommates came with me.
Okay.
And you know me, I don't really, like, socialize people. I don't know when I'm there. Like, I just sat there kind of like, yeah, this is cool. But, like, it was kind of, like, it was sort of awkward watching this in that,
right.
like, I wasn't responding to anything. Like, normally, like, I would do, like, jokes with you, like, do JR impressions.
Uh-huh.
And I couldn't do any of it. So I was, like, behaving watching this show.
Uh-huh.
I'll always remember that when I need to talk about this when I watch this show. It's this bizarre thing. And, like, I was looking around. I was like, I don't really want to be friends with any of these people.
Uh-huh.
So that's that. But anyway. I went to that because I remember when I watched it live, like, JR kept saying concussed. And I'm like, what a silly word concussed
right.
is. Now it's just a part of our lexicon. But aside from the concussion issues, which, again, it kind of make me kind of cringe when I watch it.
Well, not only that.
This was a good match and a hot opener. They do a title change. The Dudleys. Everything was over. Like, let me tell you how everything was over.
Mm-hmm.
Like, really caught me. Again, those 2015 goggles.
Right.
They did the Dudleys did the what's up drop, which, like, now is kind of like eye rolling when you think about it. This thing got so over. When they got ready for the crowd was insane for us. All of the traditional Dudley's Edge and Christian spots were really over here. And we should talk about
that's in my notes. The Dudley's were tremendous faces here.
Yeah, and you know, obviously we should talk about from the last year where the Dudley's kind of came into their own and the tables match with the Hardys. Mm-hmm. They became the unlikely breakout babyface team. All the Hardys were very over as babyfaces as well. Edge and Christian were the breakout heel team. They turned out to be the best of the three, in my opinion. What a 2000 they had.
Right.
The titles had changed hands among those three a lot of times, quite frankly. Title changes, you know, we kind of ruminated about that at some point in that 2000 mini episode that, you know, maybe there was a few too many title changes during this period.
Sure.
But there was one here. But this is a good match. This is like a three-star match. This is a solid opener to get the crowd moving.
But before we let go of this here, the one thing I want to note also, too, for again, all of the anachronistic talk about concussions here, things that we would fart at today, they also actually at one point used the term bruised brain, I believe, that Bubba had, as far as really getting technical about this, really establishing that it was a concussion. So it's so weird, too, because we just had a sports medicine doctor on the show recently, Dr. Kenneth Aline, and I asked him about this. I said, have you ever watched any old sports stuff that you watch now? And it's just like, ooh, I can't believe I saw that. He said, yeah, I was watching a game with my son recently from the 1960s where you could see they sent the guy back in with a concussion. It's like, ooh. So that wasn't the case here. Bubba, I'm pretty sure they were doing a kayfabe deal. But
yeah, he wasn't legitimately, but yeah, that was like a big thing.
Making light of it in a way that we never would or should.
No, they would never do, oh, this guy's got a concussion, because they'd get a ton of shit for it.
Right.
We should talk about this. There was a segment here. There were a lot of bizarre backstage segments during the show. Like, there was something with, like, the APA, like, doing the I'll show you mine if you show me yours, and it turned out to be their Rumble numbers, which
it started last year, we said, in 2000 with the Rawification of the Rumble.
Yeah.
With
and, like, Crash Holly showed up and cut this right thing. There were a lot of, like, backstage things. One of them, and really kind of one of the most prominent things on this show, and this, I don't know, some people enjoyed this. Mm-hmm. I didn't enjoy it, was the participation of Drew Carey. Now of Price is Right fame, then of the Drew Carey Show fame, I guess. He was doing, I guess, some comedy pay-per-view, and they worked him in, and we all know where it goes, that he participates in the Rumble. I guess that was okay, because it was kept very brief, but these backstage segments were kind of cringeworthy, I thought. Like, he came in, and I don't know if he was trying to make a joke or not, but, like, he confronts Triple H and Stephanie, who are going over for the World Title. He's like, George's like, oh, you married the boss's daughter? He's like, sorry, I haven't been watching much lately. Is Kamala? He's like, is Kamala around here? And Triple H just looked like he wanted to, like, leave. He's like, why am I doing this?
I have that in my notes that he did that. Yeah, and Drew Carey, Cleveland's own, a good talk show host. Not on the level, I would say, of six-time lounge guest Bob Barker, but a good talk show host.
No, he's a downgrade from my main man, Bob Barker.
Well, but I had to get in that plug. But, no, I agree with you. I mean, it was really goofy how they had it set up here. It prefaced him being in the actual match itself.
Yeah, and they did a thing later on in the show where he meets Trish, because Stephanie and Trish were doing their feud.
Right.
And Stephanie's like, oh, I'll introduce you to Trish, and you can hit on her and stuff like that. Because, you know, Trish was dating Vince in the story at the time, and Stephanie hated that. So, and that's how, you know, Vince came in.
A jealous Vince McMahon puts him in.
Yeah, Vince's like, well, you should join the Rumble. And it was all right. Again, it gives, I guess, in a match that, again, I talked about the framework, you can only do so much. And, you know, by the time we're now in 2015, the Rumble's maybe gotten a little repetitive. We haven't seen a lot of new things. At least the Drew Carey, like, it's one of the things you remember about this Rumble is Drew Carey, right, wrong, you know, good, bad, or otherwise.
Right.
But one of the things that I remember about this show, Rick Morris, as we double back here, I would argue the highlight of this show is on the undercard. Very rare that an undercard match, quote unquote, steals the show.
Okay.
On WWE, you know, kind of when the way they built their template in 98, the main event was always the best show.
Right.
Best match on the show. You very rarely, and there's certainly instances and exceptions where this happens, but it's very rare that an undercard match is the best on the show.
Right.
But it is here, and that's Chris Jericho, Chris Benoit ladder match, Intercontinental title.
Mm-hmm.
I gave this 4 3/4 stars, same as Triple H Foley from the year previous. I'll give a slight lean to Triple H Foley over this, but my God, was this an unbelievable match?
Right.
And I suppose we do need to speak on the Benoit factor.
Right.
This is the first time that we talk about him. This is his first appearance. And when I watched this again, and it had been a long time since I'd seen it, I kept thinking two things to myself. God damn it, Chris Benoit, why did you murder your family? Because this man was quite simply one of the greatest professional wrestlers that ever lived.
Agreed.
I mean, this guy, you just like, they just did a video package for this. You talk about the video packages being effective. Like, the way it was cut and stuff like that. You're like, how awesome was this Chris Benoit?
He was my favorite.
And I remember coming into this, and maybe I didn't enjoy it as much of the time. It didn't have just as much to me sitting at some random church in Athens. Is I was a little sour that both these guys had taken what I thought was a step back to the Intercontinental title picture after sort of failed world title runs. You know, in that summer of 2000, we saw Benoit not go over The Rock, Jericho lose the Triple H, that fully loaded pay-per-view.
Well, in Austin's absence, both of them dipped the toe in the main event scene and then came back.
Yes, and then Austin came back and they really sort of, well, we had nothing for him.
Right.
Well, not nothing for him, but they moved on. But
creators got nothing important for you.
Yeah, but I'll say this. When you just watch this show, you kind of forget about that. And this was just unreal. I think this was the best match these two ever had. God, I've been slipping on my words a lot in these podcasts.
Well, I'll tell you what. Even
better than the famous match they had in 95 at the Super J Cup.
Okay.
Which was kind of the match that put Jericho on the map internationally.
Right.
You know, he used that to go to ECW.
Right.
And then, you know, it was WCW. And
that's
then
right.
What have you. But this was the best match these two ever had. I would argue this may be Jericho's best singles match ever.
It could be. I mean, I don't
think I ever gave a Jericho singles match 5 stars.
I couldn't muster a star rating. This is the first Benoit match I have watched since the tragedy. And that was, I mean, it was something I had kind of gone back and forth on. And I decided that to do this and to do this right, I mean, I got to watch the match. And it's just, I can't disagree really with anything that you said about the match. I mean, it was really, you know, I'll never get back into watching a Chris Benoit match like I used to. I don't plan on making a pattern of it.
I was fighting myself. I was like, I don't, like, it speaks to him how good he was in the ring. Because I wanted to be like, you piece of shit.
Yeah.
But, like, I'm watching, I'm like, Jesus, this man was so good. Like, everything he did was so crisp.
Kyle, if we're conflicted, if we think this is hard, what are we going to feel like when we watch the 03 Rumble? That's going to be a hard one
and
to sit
through. And 04, the actual Rumble.
04, yeah.
03
also,
and 04,
yeah.
I mean, when he's actually, when he's more of a centerpiece of the show.
Yeah.
I know, it's going to be tough.
It's really going
to
be difficult.
At least we don't have to do WrestleMania 2000.
Well, yeah, exactly.
Or WrestleMania 20, pardon me. WrestleMania 20.
Well, yeah, yeah. I
also
never
glad
do that
we
one.
Don't have to do WrestleMania 2000.
Well, yeah, exactly. Could never do that one quite the right way. But, I mean, technically it was fine. It was great. I got into it as much as I possibly could, which that's a very low bar. I can't get into a Chris Benoit match that much for the obvious reasons. I agree with you on everything that you said.
Were some incredible spots in this match. There, the one point when they did the spot where Jericho hooks him in the walls of Jericho on the ladder, like Benoit's bent over the top of the ladder, is like insane. There's something where Jericho pins him underneath the ladder, and Benoit like still does this feat of strength where he pushes up, and Jericho goes flying. There's one spot that you just cringe on because you obviously know
the headbutt thing.
Yes,
yeah.
Benoit does a tope, and he takes a sick, unprotected chair shot to the head, flying out of the ring. And you just, because you know, obviously, you know from the autopsy what his brain came
that
up.
That had something to do with it.
And you're just like, oh, God, you can't take that. Like, I remember at the time thinking of that, being like, and they kept replaying it, too. Remember, they keep, like, Jerry Lawler, who I have to take issue with, he really was descending into even more so into hideousness here. He kept like, I want to see that again. And
hey,
at the time,
I think that's the one that's going to make him kill his family.
Yeah, and it's like, I remember the time being like, Benoit is crazy to take that shit. And now you watch, you're like, God, I wish he wouldn't have.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that's so bad.
Choose your words more carefully in retrospect, announcers.
Yes. But, yeah, this was unbelievable. Jericho goes over and wins the title. It felt like it didn't mean much because you kind of forgot about what the Intercontinental title meant here. The Intercontinental title had kind of taken a step back at some point.
Thing. You know, and the one thing I want to put in here in terms of talking about a Chris Benoit match, I'm going to reference the weekend after the tragedy, we recorded a live full edition of the FDH Lounge that you were there for on the Sunday night, the weekend after the tragedy.
Oh, I was.
You were. And I said at the time.
Oh, I remember that now.
Yes. And I said at the time, I predicted correctly, I would not be watching any Chris Benoit matches. I didn't anticipate doing a series like this subsequently where
little
I have
you know,
to.
Little did you know you'd have to deal with me.
Yeah, well, exactly. But I said at the time, I said, I think we're going to look at this like trying to evaluate Chris Benoit as a professional wrestler is going to be like trying to evaluate Hitler as a painter. And I don't think it was quite on that level.
No.
Not quite.
No, that was a little extreme.
We were feeling extreme things the weekend after the tragedy. But that's, I just wanted to revisit what I said in the immediate aftermath, because it didn't quite feel that way. It didn't feel good, though, let me tell you. It did not. I wanted to shower after I watched Chris Benoit's match. So I won't be watching any more of them than I need to do our reviews.
Okay. Jerry Lawler, I just want to bring up, he had some terrible takes in this match.
Well, yeah.
At one point, JR, oh, who, by the way, got in his first, we got our first XFL reference along the way here. There was some spot where somebody got hit by the ladder, and JR goes, well, it's just like a fair catch in the XFL. And I was like, the fucking XFL. Why did they do that? The XFL was really bad.
One of the things that helped kill the boom.
Yes.
One of them.
But Lawler at one point, so when JR said we're live in 70 countries, Jerry Lawler, and I know he was kind of playing like the stupid old man at this point, goes, I didn't even know there were 70 countries on Earth. That's just like that makes your, you know how they're fighting, especially now for these advertisers?
Right.
And it's so, I know this is like me being Nelson Picker for a change.
Right.
That kind of shit makes your product seem so stupid.
Here's a funny thing. We bemoan today's product. We bemoan the corporate PG nature of it. That's one of the rare points where being corporate and PG is good. They would never make that joke today.
They would never say that because, you're right.
Because today they realize how dumb it makes them look.
Yeah, and you know, I don't know if it was just Lawler, having no leash or whatever. Oh, and then I'm sure Bret Hart really enjoyed during this match saying, did Shawn Michaels invent the ladder match? I'm sure Bret, the sound you hear off camera here is Bret throwing things in his Canadian home saying, I'll kick you, I'll potato your ass again, Jerry.
Well, you know what, too? I love Bret Hart, a repeat past guest of the show, but has there ever been anybody in the business where it's easier to get their goat with something like that?
Bret takes things seriously.
He's the easiest guy to troll that there's ever been in the business.
It's
funny. Maybe not anymore, but he used to be before his injuries.
Well, it's funny, Meltzer has made this point a bunch of times that if you're like a younger fan and you go back and you watch the stuff with the Survivor Series screw job. You're probably like, what in the hell is the problem with these people? Why do they care so much about who's going over in this frickin' match? It's like we're so desensitized to winning and losing now, which isn't a good thing necessarily, but like those two, like that was the furthest it had ever taken, and it was taken to a point of ridiculousness. But you know what I'm saying? Like if you're to watch Wrestling with Shadows, and now if you're a younger fan, you watch it, and Bret just absolutely going insane, I am not losing. This would be like my character blowing its brains out.
Yeah.
You're just like, you'd be like, what is wrong with you?
You know what's hilarious to me? I never thought of this until you said this. But
I'm stealing Meltzer's point.
Okay. You know how 98 played off the 97 finish with Deadly Games and how they've ripped off the Survivor Series finish a million times since. Starrcade 99. Okay. To a kid that you're just showing this, that
you're
wasn't even alive
then.
Yeah, the Survivor Series finish. To a kid who's watching this, it's like if he's seen the ripoffs of the Survivor Series finish before the actual one, imagine the confusion it must be. Like, well, why is he getting upset? That's like when they did the story where they screwed over Mick Foley the next year.
Yeah.
That's kind of funny, actually.
And it's also funny that he is to the point in his age where he didn't see it, and they're still rehashing an angle from long ago, which is another issue another day. Benoit Jericho loved it. I think I have this as all of all matches that took place at a Royal Rumble pay-per-view. The old school list of lists, if you all remember.
Okay.
There was a show once upon a time I did that.
Yep.
I have this number 4.
Okay.
But it's tied for the number 2 ranking at 4 3/4. So number 3 will be coming up soon.
Okay.
It's a very strong top 4.
I don't think it's Ivory China.
No, it's not Ivory China, because we go from the best of times to the worst of times.
Yeah.
The less said about this, the better.
Okay.
Again, if you want to compare this to 2000, so we've gone over, Triple H Foley was the match of the year contender in 2000, Benoit Jericho here. This probably was worse than Mae Young showing her tits. This ivory China.
Considerably.
Segment.
Well, because they weren't her real tits. That's how you know it's worse. They were gimmick tits, and it was funny.
So
you know it was funny.
Like, this is one of the things, because it was like the show is not built around this match, so this cannot in any way diminish how much I like the show overall.
Right.
But this is the app. Really, it's the only shitty part of the show.
Mm-hmm.
This ivory China bit where, first, I hated China at this point. I wanted her to go out. I know that behind the scenes, some things were conspiring against her in her life. Quite frankly, has never been the same since.
Which, again, I referenced this before. She apparently, to hear her now, she was months away from finding out about any of this still at Royal Rumble at 01.
And you know what?
What?
She was still being placated a little bit. She was still getting pushed.
Sure.
So I'm wondering if she's being truthful, which she's not very often.
Might be right.
Like that like,
it was a double life.
Like that she, I mean, she might be stupid for it, but.
Right.
She was still being placated. She was getting pushed. But
I kind of believe her because she was getting the Mr. McMahon guilt booking. Like, she still doesn't know. Yeah. Let's keep her in the main spot on the women's side.
But you know what? All that being said, I have no sympathy. Like, you should feel
right.
bad for her. But you watch this, and I just. So what happens is they do this match. Ivory was part of the Right to Censor group, a group that I thought was not used to the most of its potential.
Right.
It became kind of like a jobber group, but I thought they could have been a nice foil for Austin right when he came back. Steve Austin versus Stevie Richards ain't going to light the world on fire, but Austin beating him up would be okay.
It's too bad that nobody in that group had the power of ESP, because Ivory could have cut some amazing promos. You know, you will go on to become... someone that does gangbang porn videos. You know, that would have been great. I would have smiled at that.
So I don't even remember how this was set up other than...
Alleged neck injury.
Ivory was the women's champion. This is the women's title match. And they did a spot here. And the match just ends out of nowhere when China does her really stupid handspring elbow that
mm-hmm.
was, you know, 0.3 Muda. And she lands wrong, and they do this serious neck injury that no one bought.
Yep.
And JR and King are doing the hushed voices. There had been some injury angle where China had, like, she had was coming back here from, I guess, what was being booked as a serious career-ending neck injury.
Yeah.
To be honest, I blocked that out of my mind.
Is this the first time
she had wrestled since that angle, since coming back?
Right. Is this the first time JR and the King, when they were trying to sell something super serious, went to the Owen voices? Is this the first time they used it in a fake way?
I can't remember that.
I think it is. I think it is. Shame on you guys is all I got to say.
This was bad.
Yep.
This was really bad. How it just ended. And, like, what made it worse is China totally was squashing Ivory before the angle. So, like,
right.
she basically... was squashing Ivory and then did this out of nowhere abrupt injury angle.
Right.
We were supposed to feel sympathy for her. And it just didn't work. Like, she was like this indestructible Amazon
right.
for the first 90% of the match. And then it's like, oh my God, she's hurt.
Right.
We must feel such sorrow for her. This didn't work. China was, again, she really squashes Ivory at WrestleMania 17, which
right.
is like the low point of that show. It's even worse than the gimmick Battle Royal. And after that, she's gone. She finds out, and they get rid of her.
I share your distaste for the general direction with China. I always thought that Ivory, the only GLOW alum ever to make it into the company, I always felt like she was an oasis, a quality worker in there in a division that was just full of shiznits.
She was okay. I mean, she wasn't...
Her and Molly Holly, and, like, what else was there in that whole era? I mean, I know everybody now wants to act like Trish is the greatest super worker ever just because she got to where she didn't suck toward the end, but... I don't know. And same thing with Lita. Lita was kind of a spot monkey, just like her, both of her boyfriends at one point in time. But what I find interesting.
She was okay. She was serviceable. I think, like, she was kind of like the anomaly
mm-hmm.
in that she was like the veteran female worker, whereas a lot of these other people that they brought in during this period were new.
Right.
They got bigger pushes because they had more of a star. She didn't really have a star quality. She was very good in this role.
Right.
With
she
RTC,
was.
I'll bring that up.
In this role, what I want to mention about this with STC is something it revealed about somebody else. because JR makes a comment, as I mentioned to you off air, about Ivory being her character being sexually repressed. And it's a funny thing because you've talked about this before in the Attitude Era, the progression of Mr. McMahon in the beginning to somebody that would give the big power gulp when Stone Cold was going to come after him, to a guy who believed his own BS and thought he was the toughest SOB as things moved along. Mm-hmm. JR went through a progression himself. Do you remember the earliest days of the Attitude Era of, like, my mama's watching at home, like, whenever there would be anything like that? By God, King, my mama's watching, you know, like, whenever anything would be risque. And then, like, by the end of the Attitude Era, JR is just, like, full-on embracing it. And I'm like, yeah, they should be showing their tits.
Well, because I think, you know what was
97, 98, JR wouldn't have called anybody sexually repressed. His character changed with the times.
Yeah, I wonder if that was him being a company man, because remember, this was kind of that period where they were getting, well, the whole RTC angle, what was that? It was their response to the PTC trying to pull their sponsors.
That's a good point.
So I think that JR was being a good company man.
That's a good point.
And being like, oh, you know, they should be able to show, you know, this is fun. This is just good fun. Why are you bothering us with it? I think that's what it was.
But it's not in line with, like, 98 JR is my point. So it's kind of interesting there. I just thought that was interesting.
He had more credibility in 98.
He did. He did. But
I think he cared more, too.
But this match, we get this one out of the way before we have a significant return to quality here. I mean, I don't want to overstate it because the booking was really weird. But the match for the WWF Championship definitely rebounds from this nadir that we had.
Yeah, it's a good match, but it's a weird match.
Yes.
I agree with what you just said. It's Triple H and Kurt Angle, heel versus heel. Angle's the champion, a poorly booked champion.
Yep.
And
a chicken shiznit guy on top like they like to do with The Miz, with Seth Rollins. That's how they want to book
those
guys.
And they did it with Jericho
the
year after.
Yes,
and it was funny, Angle even told Jericho, hey, you know, don't be too happy. You ain't going to be the guy.
Right.
I think there was a story Jericho talks about one of his books that Angle told him that because Jericho was basically Angle of the next year.
He was.
And
carbon copy almost.
So
the positioning.
This is one where, you know, we didn't do any real bitching about Triple H.
Mm-hmm.
In our last mini episode where we covered the 2000 Rumble, because quite frankly, there was no need to, because he put on a career making performance against Cactus Jack in the world title match. In 2000, towards the end, you started to see some of the issues that people would forever kind of gripe about with Triple H. I remember really thinking that it was the wrong move for him to go over Jericho in that Last Man Standing match. But even worse was a couple months later when it was him and Angle, and it looked like Triple H was set to go babyface and Stephanie was going to turn on him and go with Angle, and that Angle would be your new main event heel. A funny thing happened along the way, because as I just stipulated, Kurt Angle's the world champion here. Triple H beats Kurt Angle pretty clean and Unforgiven. Stephanie stays with him.
Mm-hmm.
Given what we know transpired, it's tough to make the argument that Triple H probably didn't politic to keep that.
Sure.
Now, given that they wound up getting married and had a very real life and good on-screen chemistry, I'm not going to say that Angle and Stephanie would work better than Triple H and Stephanie. So it goes back to the point again that, okay, Triple H got all these favors from the booking committee and stuff, but if anyone else got those favors, I don't think they would have done any better.
He didn't want to be storyline booking his own divorce when he wasn't in real life married yet.
And I'm not sure. It would have been interesting. Would they still? How would that have worked? Like, you know, it's funny. I think at the time, I don't know when this came out. I don't remember in the fall of 2000 knowing that they were boinking each other.
Well, oh, here's the thing, too. I go back to
When did that come out?
I go back to this before. China claims not to know until the spring of 2001, based on the shoot interviews.
Yeah, I know.
So here's the funny thing. When he's at home talking to her, what justification does he give for not wanting to break up with Stephanie on screen? Well, yeah. You know, Joni, that just wouldn't work for me.
Yeah.
How about that?
Yeah.
Thanks
for this briefcase, but I'm going to go now. Didn't she, like, have a briefcase or something like that?
Yeah, something
big thing.
Like that.
So I'm not going to complain about the Stephanie not going with Angle part.
Right.
But Angle clearly should have been booked better in these months, because he was booked perfectly before that. Actually, to be honest with you, he probably did too many jobs, and he still got over, which speaks volumes that, like, you know, nobody did that many jobs as a heel.
Right.
On the ascent, like, you remember, he jobbed to, like, the Big Show in a comedy match at Backlash.
Yep.
He jobbed to the Undertaker at Fully Loaded.
Yeah.
Pretty clean. And yet, you still knew. I remember pretty early in the year, I did find him, like, this is the guy who should beat Rock for the title.
Mm-hmm.
And he did, and it was a good match, but they never went with him as the lead heel because they were doing the whole Triple H was the mastermind behind running Austin down.
Yep.
And he never went full babyface, although he wrestles Benoit at the October pay-per-view as a babyface.
Yeah.
After kind of being a heel. Like, he was this weird tweener in the early fall.
It was like The Rock's pseudo-face turn the fall of 98. Almost identical.
Not nearly as effective, though.
No.
Like,
no.
The Rock,
I'm not commenting on effectiveness, but positioning.
Yeah, but you're right.
Hotter as a face, because it's like, damn it, I don't know if I'm supposed to cheer for him. And it's like, but that makes it even hotter, because it's almost like the forbidden fruit as far as the psychology to the fans.
You know what? Actually, that's a very good point.
Yeah.
Because the people really did want to cheer for him.
They did.
And
they wanted desperately.
But what the difference is came with the heel turn. With The Rock, the heel turn worked beautifully.
Right.
With Triple H, I guess it worked pretty well as well, but in his case, it came at the expense of Angle. Like, Angle was of kind of a geek. He was booked as a geek,
right,
is the term. He was always winning fluky in his matches, whereas Triple H would always win in, like, this epic fashion when he was the heel champion, so there was a big difference there, and I get it, okay? Triple H was their long-term heel. Angle wasn't. You can bitch till the cows come home that it should have been the other way.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't, and I'm not. Although Angle is the one guy who I think could have maybe gotten over more in Triple H.
Here's the thing. Let me say this. I agree with the commonly accepted IWC consensus that the downfall of the company creatively in the 2000s, the first tiny seed, was the way that they resolved Triple H Angle in September of 2000. I agree with that. That's the beginning of the danger signs to come. Having said that, the one thing I can say in the company's defense is, structurally, especially with Austin coming back, you always need strong heels to counteract the faces. Austin and Rock needed, collectively, Triple H and Angle on the other side. That kept it even at the top.
Well, there was Benoit, who didn't kind of got shafted, too.
Benoit and Grant, and you did have The Undertaker coming back, but you had...
He's a face,
Undertaker
though.
Undertaker has a face.
Yeah.
So that, for balance sake,
yeah, and they,
I'll,
and they even,
I'll justify
they, I mean,
it.
Well, they turned Rikishi.
Right.
Yeah, which didn't really work
so well. One of the worst ideas ever.
It kind of killed him, although I thought he had maybe kind of peaked as a babyface, too. He was not going to be, like, a main event babyface.
Well, it was pathetic, and we'll see this with Rumbles to come, is when they tried to flip him again like nothing had ever happened, it fell so flat.
No, that was bad. That was bad. But this match, you know, heel versus heel matches typically don't work.
Right.
And they always kind of lead to dead crowds. But with the dynamic here that was off is, Angle was almost portrayed in this sympathetic light.
Right.
You know, like, oh, like, he didn't get Stephanie. You know, Stephanie kind of, like, turned him down.
Mm-hmm.
And he's proving himself because, you know, Kurt Angle may be the WWF champion, but by God, Triple H is still the game. And that means more than being the WWF champion.
Yep.
And
it's like the being John Cena championship.
Yeah. And he goes over here. He finally gets his win over Triple H, but it was only because of interference from Austin.
Right.
I mean, they do a lot of cool false finishes here, kind of, you know, like, you know, 2 3/4 counts. It's a good match. I give it 3 3/4, but you just had the feeling that they had actually missed their window with Angle going over Triple H.
Right.
To me, logically, you have Angle go over Triple H on his way to winning the title, not after.
Right.
Although, again, I guess it's a case of, okay, well, Angle needs opponents as his champion, but Angle was just never booked strong.
It was a strange dynamic.
Didn't Eric Angle get involved at the Survivor Series? They did some goofy finish where he beat Undertaker.
I don't know that. It might have happened.
I'm pretty sure they did.
Okay.
There was that 6-way Hell in the Cell at Armageddon where he kind of won on a fluke.
Mm-hmm.
I think somebody else did all the damage and he, like, rolled over and got the pin.
Mm-hmm.
So they did not get the most out of Kurt Angle, who could have been a great heel champion and was really not here.
Right.
He winds up losing the title to The Rock the next month on pay-per-view.
Exactly. One of the rare times that they have moved a title off of the champion before WrestleMania and then moved the champion down the card. That hasn't generally happened. Generally, if you left Royal Rumble with the title, you still
had a very
good chance.
Was this the first time that happened?
I think it is, actually. I mean, notwithstanding weird years like 97 where they were playing ping pong with it, that
you're right,
doesn't 90, count.
Yeah, yeah 97,
if
you're
take
right.
97 out of the mix. I mean, we're doing this off the top of our heads, people. That's what big nerds we are, that we can do this off the top of our heads. I don't think any other year they ever did that.
No.
So,
yeah, you're right.
It's a, and then
99, in 99, they did The Rock left Royal Rumble with the title. And remember, they flipped a couple times
right.
with him and Foley. Leading up to it.
In the era subsequently, of one of the things that I hated the most, the Elimination Chamber in February, so that the whole WrestleMania main event could be up for grabs 4 months or 4 weeks before the actual thing. That probably happened a few times in the brand split era, but it happened here, and it was kind of strange and notable that it did. One other note that I had was about the positioning in this match. Trish Stratus and Stephanie McMahon.
I thought that took away from the match.
But here's the thing, too, that the storyline between them was, you know, who's the most powerful female in the WWF. And here's what I'm thinking. This is what jumps out at me. When you're doing a historical project here like we are and looking back over time, not until you got it. We talk about all these things that wouldn't have come into play before the Attitude Era. It's only in the Attitude Era that, like, quote-unquote, real-life power and everything like that became a thing. Because let's say Missy Hyatt had been in the company the same time as Miss Elizabeth. It never would have been about who's got the most real-life power. It still would have all been kayfabe stuff. Here they're trying to somewhat, not exactly break the fourth wall. It's not like they were trying to sell the Trish Stratus angle as a shoot. But you know what I mean? They were moving more into the gaga of actual soap opera-ish type stuff outside the ring as opposed to the product in the ring. That's something we didn't have before the Attitude Era. You cannot picture an angle like this even in 1995 WWF. Like, who's the most powerful female in the WWF? If it was over anything, it would have been over the women's championship, and that would have been, you know, to see who's the most powerful woman. But
yeah,
so
that actually further denigrated that women's title thing.
Yeah.
Probably not by accident. But yeah, I thought like Trish's Angle's one-night manager here was kind
right.
of took away from it. Of course, all led to like that thing where Vince humiliated her on Raw.
Right,
was,
bark like a dog.
Yeah, take off your bra.
Although whenever he does that voice, it's always entertaining.
Yes.
I got to give him that.
And they did in the lead up to this. There was, you know, I do have to admit, I chuckled. The video package for this Triple H angle match.
Uh-huh.
They were showing Triple H or Trish agreeing to being Angle's manager, and Vince, what are you doing? Why are you being in Kurt Angle's corner? And Trish is like, you're right, Mr. McMahon. I've been very bad. I think you need to spank me. And Vince's facials, well, I mean, it's sort of eye rolling, I guess.
Did he give the big gulp?
I think, no, he just kept giving that, I'm very interested in what you're saying look. And that was kind of amusing.
Per Vince is always a guilty
yes.
pleasure.
Yeah, this started that period where he would just like to start groping his employees on thing while he was married. Way to go, Vince.
Yep.
My hat's off to you. So that's is that it for the world title match?
We
talked that's about
it.
Kurt Angle went over.
Yep.
It was all right, but he loses. Poorly booked champion.
That's about it.
Triple H finds a way. By the way, Triple H would then the next month beat Steve Austin the second time in less than 6 months. He beat a guy who was about ready to win the world title.
That's right.
And then he gets hurt, and no one ever got their heat back on him, really.
Just like he planned it.
So, yeah, and then, you know, Triple H will come back in 2002, and he'll be a big part of that show, but we'll talk about that in Part 4C. But
that's
before
right.
then, we've got to talk about the Royal Rumble, a very good Royal Rumble.
Mm-hmm.
I have in my notes the second best ever to this point. I give it 3.75 stars.
Yep.
I could have done without Drew Carey, although it was kept minimal enough that it was okay. And again, it gives it some of an identity, some differentiation. The ECW reunion stuff where they were doing all the hardcore things, I thought that came across as a bunch of guys who weren't that necessarily that over, just hitting each other with frying pans.
Well,
and like they needed that to get over.
I kind of agree.
I'm surprised about that. I thought you would have like thought that was like the best segment of this. Like,
well, you know, they tended to do overkill, you know, with their hardcore division, and yeah, so yeah, I didn't really necessarily think too much of it. In terms of people making cameos in the match here, surprise cameos out of nowhere, who had more credibility, Drew Carey or the Honky Tonk Man?
You know, I'm going to be honest with you. When the Honky Tonk Man came out and said, "You people are here to see me sing. You people are here to see me dance." I loved every bit of it. He takes the guitar shot from Kane here. Yeah. Kane, who's a big player in this Rumble, which irked me a lot at the time. I'm going to talk about that momentarily. But
you've always kind of had a wild hair for Kane.
Yeah, because it's always like, okay, he's being shunted down the card, and then like he randomly gets pushed. This was a very random push. Interesting that this show, they went, did they go Axe and Smash here with the Hardys starting it? No, they were 1-3.
1-3, but Jeff was eliminated by Matt after they eliminated
did,
a couple
they
guys.
They did face off.
They took out Bill Buchanan. They took out Farouk.
Yeah. But Drew Carey shows up early. He's number 5, and they do the whole thing where Kane comes out right next. And, you know, he tries bribing Kane, and Kane's just like, no, and he just jumps out. I guess that was amusing. Drew Carey was in for, what, 2 minutes? That's fine.
2:54.
Okay, that's fine. But Kane is in a lot longer than 2:54, and it was weird. Don't you agree it was weird? He was not being really pushed at all leading into this. He had come off that really stupid feud with Jericho over a cup of coffee.
Right.
And he had been a heel, and he works as a total babyface here and gets over as a babyface. It's just this total...
Only to get eliminated by Austin.
Yeah. It's this total out-of-place, confusing... But you know what I'm saying? Like, when you just watch it, like, now, in a vacuum, it's fine, I guess. But, like, I remember at the time, this effect, I was like, well, get rid of this Kane. Why is Kane being pushed?
Here's the funny thing.
And he eliminates, like, so many people. Like, isn't it still the record? Like, they still talk about this to this day at the Rumble.
Yeah. Well, I think, of course, Roman Reigns, I think, broke the record.
Oh, that's right.
In 2014. Not my boy. Here's the thing that's funny. We like to single out things that happen that kind of set the template for things to come in the business. This era, what they were doing and would subsequently do, mostly what they would subsequently do with him, Big Show, whatever, this is a prime example of what you're talking about here, what they did with him, of microwave booking. They have confidence that there are guys that they have. We can get them back in the main event scene. We just got to nuke them for a little bit. And this was their way of getting Kane
hot. That's a great comment. Microwave booking.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah,
Greg
thank
Morris.
You. Thank
I
you.
I don't like all your political takes, but I like that one.
Well, the good ones borrow, the great ones steal. I don't know where I got that from. Okay. I got that from some corner of the internet. But they like the microwave guys. This is a perfect example of that. Kane wasn't in the main event picture. Doesn't matter. We'll throw a little bit of
here's the thing, though. He wasn't after
and he
this.
He did nothing at WrestleMania of
he
any
was in
note.
A hardcore match with Raven and the Big Show. This was just like this bizarre thing that had no...
Weird timing.
Yeah.
Such weird timing.
Now, I will
to do
say
this.
There were, you know, it's funny. I kind of, as much as I bitched about the 2000 roster of guys that were... There were still some jabrones in this, but it got hot late. You had in this one Undertaker, who was not at 2000 either, by the way.
Right.
And then you have both Austin and Rock. I believe this is the only Rumble ever where both Austin and Rock were in. And it's funny that...
I think so, yeah.
Well, no, that's a lie.
Was Rock in 98?
That's a goddamn lie. They're the... Pardon me, I know. You know this is a Family Values show. they were the last two in 98.
Yeah,
and
right.
I think that they're both actually in 97, too, and Rocky was the blue chipper.
But aside from that, this is the only time they were ever in the Royal Rumble together.
This is the only time they're in it together, both as faces. How about that?
That's right. You just didn't put the proviso on it the first time.
Yes. And I think that really helped. It's funny, as much as... So Austin's your winner. Kane is like this kind of this inexplicable highlight. And he does get over by the end of the match, I should point out.
Eliminates The Rock, by the way. Yeah, and talk about trying to keep some credibility on Rikishi, albeit they blew this as a possible main event, or not main event, but WrestleMania angle. Rikishi eliminates The Undertaker.
Didn't they do something with Undertaker and Kane, like worked against Rikishi and Haku, who we should bring up? Remember, this was like, that they were really needling WCW at this point. They're like, we're just going to take Haku because you don't have him under contract. And Haku was kind of getting over as like the hardcore champion at that point.
Yeah, the reigning defending WCW hardcore champion, Haku.
I remember kind of laughing about that at the time. I remember that.
That's kind of
funny. Big Show came back in this thing after... being demoted to, wasn't he like demoted to like OVW for weight issues or he was being lazy? He came back and he like, this was another weird thing. He comes in and starts dominating and then just gets thrown out in like a minute and a half.
Eliminated by The Rock in 1:23, which goes to show you you go back 1 year in time, the positioning of him and The Rock, where it was the big main event angle at the end. Here he's just an afterthought that gets tossed.
He did, after he gets tossed, though, he does like choke slam The Rock through. They tried, yeah. But it was weird that like it's, you know what? This is like the first Rumble where they did this.
Right.
And they still do it to this day. And it makes no sense. And do you know what they do? Get a guy over and then they eliminate him.
Yeah.
Which, and like, the crowd's always pissed. Like, the crowd gets behind a guy,
yep,
and then you eliminate him. Like, so, like, a big guy comes in, he dominates, he throws up three guys, and JR goes, by God, who's going to throw out this big man? It'll take eight guys. And then, like, one guy eliminates him.
Yep.
And it makes your announcers look stupid, and it's like, well, that was odd.
That's right.
I did want to talk about The Rock, though, because although Austin's your winner, and we'll talk about him, and Kane gets that big push, I think The Rock is very underrated in this match. If there's ever been a match where post 99 Rock is underrated, it's this one. Like, okay, he's in it for like 40 minutes.
Yeah.
And he's a key part at keeping it over. And you kind of just forget about that in there.
Well, and that's the thing, too, as far as roster depth at the top. Because, and again, I think we really neglected to touch on with 2000. As you said, Undertaker was missing as well as Austin. Undertaker missing is not an oh-by-the-way thing.
No.
I mean, one of the other legitimate main event guys here. So the ability to have Rock in for 40 minutes here, as you said, that is made possible by having Austin, by having Undertaker. You don't have the waiting for Godot dynamic of, okay, the guy who's going to win is coming out later.
That's what I'm saying. This is a better Rumble than 2000. Like,
sure.
Yeah, I mean, that's what makes
Now, realistically, going in, it figured to be Austin to culminate the comeback story. But it wasn't as glaringly obvious as perhaps some other years.
Yeah. We had blood in this Rumble.
Okay. That's always a good thing to talk about.
Triple H attacks Austin as payback for
earlier
in the show, and Austin blades. So let's talk about Austin here, because I think we've covered everything else.
He did a 0.7 Muda, I believe.
Yes, he did a good blade job here. I remember at the time, so Rock, in his absence, gotten over really well as a face. Like, The Rock was, like, a face, a baby face, that was as over as really any except Austin at his peak and Hogan at his peak, right? And you could argue he was, like, right there. Like
I'd say right there.
Yeah, like, you were not going to get many guys more over as a babyface than The Rock was in 2000, right?
Yeah, because it's commonly accepted that he reached parity with Austin at some point. By Rumble 01, you'd have to say it was that point.
Okay. So I remember everyone was getting ready for Austin to come back, and, you know, whereas in 99 it was kind of a luxury to have two babyfaces that strong, here in late 2000, as we rolled to 2001, everyone was like, okay, this is kind of an issue. I don't know if we can have these guys both on the same side. Mm-hmm. And you had started to hear those rumors of the Austin heel turn coming up, which was a disaster, make no mistake about it.
Right.
Two things. I remember at the time, I thought they should have had Austin, and I'm not saying this was right, I'm just saying this is what I thought at the time, what 20-year-old Kyle Ross thought, that Austin should have just come back as a heel. Not like he couldn't have just shown up and been a heel, but he would come and he would be the guy to screw The Rock against Kurt Angle to cost him the title.
Okay.
And he would have come back, and his whole thing for coming back is, you know, you people forgot about me. This Rock's taken my spot. And that would have been his shtick to come back.
Okay.
They didn't do that. They went with the whole who ran him down angle, and that was fine. It did good business, and Steve Austin was very over as a face. In retrospect, what I think is that he never should have been a heel, ever.
Right.
And that he certainly never should have gone to WCW in that, because we'll talk a lot more about the failed invasion when we get to 2002. We're probably going to spend a lot, even before we get to the pay-per-view, we're going to talk about what a disaster
was. And I've said before, too, like how he turned heel, still trying to wear the Fock Fear t-shirts and sell merch. I mean, you need to be Mr. McMahon's corporate stooge here. You need to be wearing his suit. And,
well, the thing is, no one really bought him as heel. Like, the guy, like...
Yeah, but he was trying to have it both ways. He was being a scared coward by, I'm going to be the biggest heel I can be, but I don't want to sell any less merch.
He was effective as it, but it was a terrible decision.
I mean, just look at the business numbers. They were terrible. Right. Once he turned heel, it was a disaster. That's why, you know me, and we'll fight on this at a different show. Mm-hmm. It's why I will never put WrestleMania 17 over WrestleMania 3.
Right.
Because it's got the one of the worst endings of all time.
I know you won't, and I know that's not the way you're going to vote in the upcoming FDH Lounge Pantheon.
Well, I do have to send that to you, don't I?
Yeah.
That was a real jab.
Well, I was going to say, I just wanted to mention it.
Why didn't you say, hey, asshole, why don't you send your ballot in?
Well, here's a funny thing. I've already voted for 17. There's already a vote in it for 3, so you're going to vault 3 ahead of 17 when you do that. There's your impetus.
What about
for
a secret ballot? What am I working with Carl Rove here or what?
I guess I shouldn't be divulging this on the air. Yes. I'm not very. Yes. That's very indiscreet
maybe,
of me.
Maybe now I'm going to screw you and just vote for something else. Anyway,
that's very indiscreet.
So it's funny, but with that heel roll, so they didn't know, I guess, because they had not purchased WCW. All of the talks were in play. I think Vince in his mind was thinking, okay, maybe I can buy WCW for pennies on the dollar.
In the final 10 days before Mania, they did, out of nowhere, make that deal.
Yes.
So they had to be thinking at WrestleMania, that was an alternative. There's a place to put Austin and Rock both as faces if you send one of them to WCW. There's a way to do it. In terms of a proto-brand split, they chose not to go that way.
Okay, so look, we're going to talk a lot about brand splits in the mini episodes to come.
Yeah.
What needs to be understood, again, first and foremost, is Steve Austin never should have been a heel.
Correct.
It came from Austin originally because this is unfathomable thing today with, like, you know, when you have John Cena having been, like, the lead babyface for 10 years.
Right.
And so many guys kind of being in the same role for so long and nothing ever changes. Steve Austin felt in his mind that he had become a little stale as a babyface,
mm-hmm.
which was maybe true. Maybe he was not peak 98 Austin, but the idea that he was stale as a babyface was wrong.
He was like 85% of what he was then, which is significantly
which is
above
better than like most
almost anybody else
ever
in the industry.
In the history,
yeah, exactly. Talk about not seeing the forest for the trees.
Yeah, but that was what they did in that time. You know, you didn't stay. You always had to do things, you know, unlike today where there constantly had to be some big hook every pay-per-view. Something shocking had to happen. But when they purchased WCW,
mm-hmm.
they needed to rethink this whole thing. And granted, that was a short window, only a few days. They needed to be like, oh, my God, what? Forget about turning Steve Austin.
Right.
We all of a sudden have what's going to be a way bigger angle on our hands with getting WCW. And they screwed it up, obviously, but whatever. But it should have been the biggest thing ever.
Right.
They should have right then and there said, we are not turning Steve Austin heel. We are nixing it, and it's not going to happen. And what's funny is, and this is with the benefit of hindsight, if one of the guys, Austin or Rock, was to turn heel and go with WCW, it actually should have been The Rock, who is a guy who would get booed multiple times in big matches, the first of which was the WrestleMania match, which was in Texas, I know. But, I mean, is Nassau, New York, Brock Lesnar country?
That's a hardcore place, though. And Brock was the indomitable heel champion who didn't show any vulnerability.
Okay, well,
the kind of guy who's always going to get cheered.
He got
Hogan in Montreal was a nostalgia thing. I can rationalize away all three of these. That was Austin's hometown. You put that match in Miami, Austin doesn't get booed out of the building, but Rock's getting more cheered than Austin. Look at 2012. That was supposed to be our 2012. That was supposed to be face versus face. How did it turn out for John Cena?
Here's my point, though. Well, it didn't turn out well for Cena. That never happened to Steve Austin. Name a time when Steve Austin, in any setting, ever was anything less than cheered universally. That's what I'm saying. Like,
was there any kind of a split at SummerSlam 98? I don't remember.
No.
Okay.
It was kind of a weird. The crowd wasn't as hot, but Austin was clearly the star. And they were also subtly turning Undertaker heel anyway.
Okay.
But that was, to me, like this big misread mm-hmm. in that. It does. Okay, you bring up a good point because it was in Texas. But you're watching this match, okay?
Right.
Steve Austin versus The Rock. And one of the participants is clearly getting all the cheers from the live crowd.
Yeah.
The other guy is actually getting booed.
Yeah.
And they decide, in their infinite wisdom, to say, well, all right, the guy's going to get cheered. He's going to go heel. And it fell so flat, and it was such a mistake, and I just think that in retrospect, had they had Austin beat The Rock,
mm-hmm.
No Vince McMahon, no heel turn, just beat him. By God, Steve Austin's back on the mountaintop. And then the fallout could have been WCW, like, attacking him or something. It didn't have to be on the show. It could have been on Raw afterwards. That would have been so much better than what they did.
Here's the other thing, too, about that, is that that matchup there, in terms of having those two in there, again, it was so explosive. They were both arguably at their, like, okay, Austin maybe not at his peak. The Rock was at his peak. And it was just a way where they were looking.
It was a bigger matchup than it was 2 years previous when they had, like, WrestleMania.
It was absolutely, because The Rock was fully established at the top of the mountain. And they were looking for that redefining moment. They wanted their Bash at the Beach 96 moment of great.
Yes.
There's never been an ending of a show with more clarity as far as the change in direction of an entire company, not just the main event scene, but an entire company. And what's weird is, because the crowd was the way that they were, the crowd, there's never been a time, and this whole thing of, like, well, we'll book against the crowd and make it the way we want it to come out on TV. No, the crowd made it seem like Vince McMahon turned face by helping Hogan. And JR was having to scream over the crowd,
Austin.
Or by helping Austin, yeah. JR was having to scream over the crowd that this was an Austin heel turn, not a Vince face turn.
Yes.
You didn't need any kind of explanation at Bash at the Beach 96.
No, you didn't. It did not work. And especially when you, like, when you see how loved, like, to going back to the point of Austin, I was getting a little stale, I needed to freshen up. But he's since admitted that he was wrong.
Right.
Did you watch this show? Of course you did, because we're doing a podcast on it.
Yep.
Did Steve Austin in any way seem stale?
No.
At this show? My God, he was over here.
Right.
I just, again, like, that was something that came to me. I'm watching this. I'm like, how did anyone think that this guy should go heel?
Here's the funny thing, though. This is the funny thing, is that, like, there are things that become apparent now that weren't apparent then. Steve Austin now doing his podcast, which is really tremendous. It's enjoyable to listen to, but you hear him on other podcasts. We didn't know this at the time. Steve Austin, just like us, Steve Austin is a ginormous wrestling nerd, okay? He loves wrestling history and this and that and whatever, and booking and psychology and everything. Like Steve Austin thought in his head, I'm going to do the same thing as Hogan. And
yes,
it didn't work out that way. It was he was blinded by, they made it work there. This seems like a decent thing for here. He got fooled by the circumstances, but it came from, you know, his heart was in the right place. He thought creatively it was going to be the right thing, because Steve Austin's a guy who loves the creative side of wrestling. He'd actually be a hell of a booker, to be honest with you, if he wanted to do it.
I don't know. Some people have said he was, like, great at coming up ideas for himself, but he never really had anything for anyone else.
Well, he's a guy right now who's screaming from the hilltops about how misused Cesaro is.
Well, I know that makes
credit.
Him, like, you know, he should be, like, you know,
absolutely
winning the Pulitzer Prize in Europe.
Pretty
no,
much.
No, you're right. I guess you're right. I guess that was wrong. I guess.
Right.
Well, I guess he is good at identifying flaws, like
right.
A lot of fans are, like people like maybe you and me and people listening to this.
But I think
I don't know if he's got any ideas. I don't know if he has the idea to get Cesaro.
He's given good advice. Well, I mean, you know, he gave Kevin Owens famously the advice 10 years ago in an airport about running his mouth and, you know, trying to get over by being obnoxious. So, you know, he's got a good mind for helping people, too. I just think he thought in his own mind he was coming up with something really epic, and it was going to be as big as Hogan's heel turn.
Well,
and
they clearly want to do something, but here's the thing, again, and I get that. I get the psychology, even though it was wrong at the time and certainly in retrospect.
Right.
But once WCW fell into their lap, and I know it's hard. I wasn't there in 2001, and I can only imagine how hectic and chaotic that company is behind the scenes leading up to WrestleMania. Somebody, I don't care who, Pat Patterson, anybody, needed to stand up and scream, what the hell are we doing? We have the biggest angle of all time right now. We do not need to turn Steve Austin as a heel. He needs to be the cornerstone of WWE going against WCW stars. That's your money.
Because I don't want to hear from anybody that it was too late in that last 10 days.
Vince McMahon, honestly, when he came sauntering out for the main event, it shouldn't have been to help Austin turn heel. It should have been like, guys, we're not doing this anymore.
Well, not only that, you know, Austin has even said that, like, you know, while, you know, 2020 hindsight, he would have called it in the ring and said, Vince, I'm going to stunner you instead, and we're going to change directions here. Now, that would have been a hell of a thing to tell the boss in real time. Yeah. But here's the thing, though. For anybody that thinks it was too late, a week to 10 days out to change it, I give you WrestleMania 30, where it was decided by Vince McMahon the day of the show the streak was ending. I give you the weekend of WrestleMania 31, where when the company decided, with Brock Lesnar sticking around and Roman Reigns not over as he needed to be, Seth Rollins was going to be option C.
Remember what
they do things at the last minute all the time, even for WrestleMania. Even the biggest things
get
changed.
Now they do. Back then it was unheard of. And it was that was for the better, usually. See, when I'm reading a lot about 98, WWF and WCW right now, and I'm kind of at the late part. You know, Meltzer puts up his old observers. I like to read them. And what's interesting about the late 98 period is, like, WCW didn't even, like, attempt to have long-term booking. Like, they had no clue what Starcade was going to look like in October.
Right.
And WWF in 98 had a very clear vision. Like, they knew The Rock was going to do the big heel turn at Survivor Series. They knew probably that the plan would be to do Rock, Austin at Mania and stuff. Like, they had good long-term. Good long-term booking is the right way to do things. Like, I don't like how they change things at the last minute now.
Right.
But.
You do have to be flexible when circumstances change.
Yes, and what's funny is I actually agreed with the Rollins thing.
Yeah. It makes sense.
And, you know, the streak, whatever, I think I agree with that. I don't know if time has told the story on that. But this is an instance where, and I know it's so easy to say in retrospect, that, okay, I get it. You know, business is good. You need to do something big. Maybe creatively, you're struggling a little bit. Dude, you're getting WCW.
Right.
You don't need to do anything else. Like, that's going to be the biggest angle ever.
Right.
Like, you don't need to do something else. Like,
right.
I know that at the time, maybe, Steve Austin just going over The Rock clean in this main event would not have been earth-shattering. But it was a good match up until the end. I mean, it was a really good match, man. And you could have just started something with WCW like the night or so after.
And you could protect The Rock, too. Like,
well, the thing
ref
with the
bump, give him a finishing maneuver, one, two, but there's no ref there. You know what I mean? There's ways you can protect The Rock
they did
and defeat.
It. I mean, that's what they did. I mean, they were trying to protect The Rock. Remember, like, Austin gave like 8 billion share, whatever. I mean, they protected
him. Well, because they made it a hardcore match at the last minute.
Yeah, but you're right. They could have protected him. And if he would have gone down, I think it would have played better into, what side's The Rock? Because he comes back in the summer of 01.
Right.
Oh, is he going to be with? Because, like, no one bought that he was going to go with WCW at that point. Because Austin, I mean, you know, Austin had already gone heel.
Right.
And so what, Rock will too? No one bought that. But
right.
If Austin was like the face of WWF side, there would have been some intrigue, I think, with The Rock. And I, again, will state, maybe you go with The Rock. Is that, I talked about earlier, into 20-year-old Kyle Ross thought Austin would turn heel right when he came back, eventually go back to face. With the mentality of, I'm underappreciated, you people forgot about me and cheer The Rock. Well, you know, that could have worked for The Rock, too, in the summer of 01, where he came back and said, you people boo me at WrestleMania.
It's kind of what he did in early 03.
Yes!
Yeah.
And we would have gotten more mileage out of what was a phenomenal heel run.
Right.
Because Rock, to be honest, would be better as a heel, I think.
I'm not going to say better, although he's outstanding as a heel, but he's outstanding as a properly positioned face, which, by the way, here's a teaser for when we're doing 02. I identified when I watched the pay-per-view on something that most people would never even pick up on, the subtle seeds of what might begin to get the crowd to turn on The Rock subsequently in 02. We'll talk about that with the 02 Rumble.
Yeah, and we're going to talk, obviously, not only about that show. We're going to have to spend a lot of time before we get into the show itself, 02, with the failed invasion angle.
Yep.
Because if you just turn on, if you're like us and you're just watching the Rumble shows, you go from 2001 to 2002, you wouldn't have a damn clue in the world that the invasion ever happened.
Spoiler alert, guys. There was a tune out now if you don't want to know what happens, but they brought in WCW and the remnants of ECW and teamed them up, and it was the biggest shark show in the history of the business.
And within 5 months, it was over.
It was over. It ended with a fart instead of a nuclear bomb, and the biggest. I say the biggest underachievement in the history of the business, and I don't know if anything else even comes close, because
no, I agree with
that's
that.
The War of the Worlds that people had been pointing to for multiple years.
It's one of those things that had they done anything else, it would have been better. Like, there's very few angles in the history of wrestling where it's like, well, what do you think they should have done? I don't know anything else.
I'll tell you this. I'll say this. There, in the late 90s into like about 2000 or so, there was a bunch of guys that I met in a scratch bowling league that I fell in with that were big wrestling fans, and I used to watch monthly pay-per-views with them. We'd all go over to one dude's house and watch them. Okay, everybody there was smart fans, sheet readers, etc. Okay, so these are people that knew the business. There's one of these guys, dude, I swear to God, the spring of 99, '98, when Bischoff called out Vinnie Mac at the pay-per-view in Worcester, Massachusetts.
Slamboree 98.
Yeah. He was convinced Vinnie Mac's going to come out because he's going, you know what? How do we know behind the scenes it's not all owned by the same guy? Like, a full-on smart fan said that to me. But there was that sentiment out there, Kyle, that undercurrent of, boy, oh boy, oh boy, that's the biggest thing there could ever possibly be, is this company against this company, and they blew it. Spoiler alert, guys. I hope I didn't ruin it for you.
You know what my favorite part of that angle was at Slamboree 98?
What?
Tony Schiavone busting out. Well, we'll know it's Vince if Jim Ross gets out first carrying his bags.
That was outstanding.
That was like the only thing that Schiavone ever said that was funny.
Yeah.
Actually, I take that back. The highlight of that show was the Dean Malenko dressing up as Cyclope. But Schiavone's burn was number two.
That was pretty damn good. But, yeah, there's a lot of intrigue to get to. Some table setting that we'll have to do on O2. But it'll be very, very interesting there because, again, we had, of the three huge breakthrough stars of the Attitude Era, Rock, Austin, Triple H, it would be the only time when all three of them in early 02 would be in full alignment as actual faces. And it was to be short-lived in the case of some of the three of them. But as far as it went, the seeds of the downfall of Rock and Triple H as faces in 02, I think were apparent. Not apparent yet with Triple H at the Rumble, but certainly with The Rock. And we'll talk about that certainly as well. Anything else to get to on 01?
No, I think a very good show. Comparable to 2000. It's the second best Rumble I've seen so far. And business is good, but not for much longer, huh?
Exactly. Business is not going to be picking up as we move through the 2000s. But it'll still be very interesting.
We will not go to the nadir of part two on this odyssey of the 93 to 95.
No.
It will never get to that point.
Bad years are coming, but 02 is not nearly as bad as they're going to be. We'll get to that next time. Thank you for tuning in, everybody.
As we bring the show to a close, we would like to extend our deepest gratitude to NBC, CBS, ABC, Fox, all Clear Channel affiliates, TNT, TBS, USA, UPN, Deadspin.com, YouTube.com, YTMND.com, MySpace.com, various blogs, Fox News, CNN, CNBC, MSNBC, IamBored.com, Billboard.com, Google.com, ESPN, ESPN2, ESPN News, ESPN Classic, NBA TV, NFL Network, Sports Time Ohio, Athlon Magazine, Comedy Central, Cartoon Network, The Boomerang Channel, QVC, BET, The Spice Channel, Steno Notebooks, Manwich, Papermate Office Supplies, Waitresses, Strippers, Bartenders, Garbage Men, Janitors, Microwave Popcorn, The Writers of The Office, Scrubs, Entourage, My Name is Earl, Oz, Metalocalypse and the Boondocks, Aquafina, and The Periodic Table of Elements.